can have your attention. We're going to get started because we have a fantastic conversation that I know probably could go on the rest of the day, but we only have an hour, so please find your seat. So it hasn't snowed yet, and I don't think it will, but again, we have been remarking on this gorgeous view we have, and we can just all look and see that possibly it's snowing out there over the Olympics and not here. But thank you all for coming again, and we're going to get started, and I just want to tell you who's on stage, because we're going to remove the screen so it's not blocking their face. So on stage right now, right here to my left, is Lynn Tye, who's a district representative for U.S. Congressman Adam Smith. Next to Lynn, we have Martin Edlin, who's the CEO of Malaria No More. And in the middle, we have Tamara Power Drudas, who's the executive director of Crosscut, and she'll be our moderator here today. Next to Tamara, we have Greg Allgood, who's the vice president for water from World Vision. And next to Greg, we have Jolene Sanjak, who's the chief program officer at Landesa. And in a previous life, she was the deputy vice president for the Millennium Challenge Corporation. Next to Jolene, we have Mike Stevens, who's the Washington State Director for the Nature Conservancy. So our panel discussion now is about global development post-election. So I'll turn it over to Tamara to tee up the conversation. Thank you.
Well, welcome everyone, and thank you for joining us. I'm glad you're bringing a sense of humor to the room. My name is Tamara Power Drudas, and I'm the executive director at Crosscut Public Media. If you're not familiar with Crosscut, we are a reader-supported online journalism site. We believe that an informed public is one which is capable of solving the challenges of our time. So we provide in-depth coverage of politics, tech, business, arts, and culture. And you can check us out on crosscut.com. It's really an honor to be here today and to have the opportunity to ask some questions that I think we've all been chewing on to really quite an extraordinary panel of experts. We're going to be diving into what does global development and global health look like under the new administration? How do we keep global development from becoming a partisan issue in Congress? And then how do we as a community work to continue to improve lives globally? We wanted to reiterate that this is not designed to be an anti-Trump discussion, but we do face many challenges ahead when it comes to global development from curing and ending infectious diseases like malaria and pneumonia to displacement and the concerns that come with that to kind of a broader conversation about health and equity. So we thank you for joining us. And we did not end up having time today for Q&A, so we hope that you will use your mobile app and Twitter to engage in the conversation and stick around after if you have any specific questions for our panelists today. We had a chance to touch base last week and kind of talk a little bit about the topics that we wanted to share. And one of the themes that I thought really came out from the conversation was a focus on how important partnerships, how important civil dialogue and bipartisanship and also collaboration are now more than ever. So we hope to bring you some tools and some good thinking in terms of how you can frame the work that you're doing around the issues you care about. So without further ado, let's dive in. To kick us off, I'm wondering, this has been a year of tremendous surprises in elections and a kind of growing rise of nationalism and some backlash to globalization. Is that a blip on the radar? Is that a growing trend? And how are you adapting or reframing the issues that you're working on in light of that? And maybe you can kick us off.
Wow, geez. Tamara, I was hoping that you'd look past me to... From our office, from Adam's perspective, is that, regardless of whether this is a trend or a blip in the radar, it certainly is an opportunity for us to engage our neighbors differently, for sure. And last week we were having our retreat out in DC, and I got to see firsthand how animated my boss really is, and seeing that is for him, he see that my work is more important than ever, in representing, you know, the voice of Washingtonian or 9th Congressional District here in Capitol Hill, and seeing him animated on that restored and renewed our staff in terms of commitment and to engage more with the people at home, but also to the work of around, you know, framing it in a context that this is going to be an important test to our democracy, to a test to our Constitution, and we're optimists. We're optimistic about that elasticity, the ability for us to hold and support and defend the constitutions in the best viability is more important than ever. And so in that, in this seemingly chaotic environment, it is part of the chaos, you know, I was thinking about before coming today, part of the Chinese character of chaos is opportunity. And so we need a frame in that one. You've got to see, find the opportunities in this and make sense, because the work we do is important. The people that we help lives in that chaos a lot. And so we need to sort of like understanding that and internalize and own that piece so that we can be a better service to them. That would be my thought.
Yeah, so advice to the crowd to pick up some Sun Tzu and...
The Art of War is not exactly what I'm thinking about. but definitely the Lao Tzu would be a good reading on that.
Wonderful. Yeah. And so Martin, in announcing his candidacy, Trump had said, quote, that we will stop sending foreign aid to countries that hate us. But that also we would continue to play a role as a peacemaker and that we continue to be a humanitarian nation. Give us your best guess as to what we can expect for global health and development funding under an America First administration.
Thanks, Tamara. So I think the honest answer is it's just too early to know. And for all of us in the room who care so passionately about our issues, we, you know, there's this urge to do something, right? Almost a spasmatic response to, I need to do something. And what I would urge people to think about, and certainly what we're thinking about on the issue of malaria at Malaria No More, is understand first what you're trying to accomplish, then understand who you're dealing with and what their attitudes are, and then how to position your issue for success. And so, you know, as we think through those three things on global health and development broadly, and malaria particularly, on the first count, we don't know what we're trying to accomplish. We don't know what the challenges are that we face. If you Google Trump and malaria, 9 out of the top 10 hits are a Jimmy Kimmel joke that he made to open one of the award shows where he willfully mispronounced Melania Trump, malaria Trump. And so there's an off-color joke about malaria Trump that's out there on the internet. The only other thing that you see out there high up in the hit rankings is President-elect Trump talking about raising some questions about the environment and saying that there's a debate about environmental science and that maybe our resources should be better spent on things like giving people clean water or ending lingering diseases like malaria. So between those two things, we don't know what we're dealing with. We also don't know who we're dealing with, right? If I was working on environmental issues and Pruitt was named the head of EPA, I might have a better sense for what I'm dealing with. But we don't know who the Secretary of State is going to be. We don't know who the USAID administrator is going to be. We don't even know who the President's Malaria Initiative coordinator is going to be moving forward. And those people matter a lot. I can say Mike Pence, you know, Vice President-elect Mike Pence, is a big champion for these issues. Was when he was in the House. He was on the malaria caucus when he was in the House. So you've got to know your audience. And then you've got to be really thoughtful about how you position the issue. I would make a case that ending one of the world's oldest, deadliest diseases is a demonstration of American greatness, right? And you can play to a lot of Trumpian themes with that kind of message. I would also argue that it's vital to our security issue interests, there's a powerful argument around ROI and creating markets for American goods. So there are lots of arguments, lots of ways to position your issue and broadly global health and development issues in this administration.
Wonderful, thank you. And for those of you that don't know, Jolene was formerly at the Millennial Challenge Corporation and served as the Deputy Vice President, had the opportunity to work under several secretaries or work with several secretaries of state. Can you talk a little bit about the role of the Secretary of State, USAID, the Security Council, in terms of how they will influence or shape diplomacy abroad or international aid?
Yeah, and you know, the funny thing is, this morning I went online to see if maybe there was an update on what people were saying about best guess for who is going to be Secretary of State, and the first thing that came up was, good luck figuring out Trump's approach on foreign policy. So that was a good preface for this question. But anyway, if I think about people, I think about you know, Mitt Romney and Tillerson are probably not going to have too big of a sway. Each Secretary of State does put their imprint. So Secretary Clinton had made a big impulse on food security through Feed the Future, which was launched by her. But you know, I think that Romney is not too far outside of the current scenario on development and development policies. He might tilt it more toward the lean, kind of efficient approaches to development and private sector-led approaches. Same thing, I would guess, Tillerson. If you think about Petraeus, for example, Petraeus might, you know, since 9/11, there's been an increasing dance between development and defense, and right now that's very collaborative. How far Petraeus might tilt that towards the defense side doing more and more and having more and more of the appropriation go that way is something I would be watching. If Bolton gets in, then the big implications for the UN, and we just are celebrating the SDGs and all that brings as leverage for us in our different, you know, land agendas, malaria agendas, and other things. But I think the other point that you mentioned other agencies, and I wanted to stress that the Secretary of State, you know, has influence on the development agenda, but equally, and maybe even more importantly in this administration, things like the role of the National Security Council and things like the presidential summits, trade agreements, and presidential policy directives. So Obama put in place a directive that elevated development as part of strategic diplomacy. This question of globalization and nationalism, I think that is protective of development within that, whether it's broadly known in the US population or not is a question. But then you think of the heads of agencies. So you mentioned the head of USAID, hasn't been named yet, would have obvious impact and different degrees of independence depending on who the person is picked. But also USTR, for example, that person hasn't been named. Trump is clearly focused on trade policy. It's all over the first 100 days. During CAFTA, the USTR had huge impacts on USAID and what they could and couldn't do in the Americas. And then the Hill, right? The Hill, the appropriations processes, the oversight roles. So the FY17 appropriation process just passed two important pieces of legislation, the Global Food Security Act and the Transparency and Accountability and Development Assistance Act. That might not be the exact titles, but the last one you think about, that's calling for and locking in legislatively evidence-based and transparent development. I'm not sure how the evidence-based is going to play out in the world we're in now, just to say something. So I'll leave it at that. But things to think about.
Yeah, well, maybe we can dive a little bit into that question around what, you know, how do we work under a bit of an unknown in the American electorate. So Mike, over to you. You know, we have a little bit better of a sense of how Trump feels about climate and climate change, and his promise to end or cancel the Paris climate deal. He has, however, since then kind of reopened conversation and seems to spur a little bit more of kind of an open door for conversations around climate change. So what ways should the environmental movement be evolving based on this election and based on kind of our sense of where the American electorate is at today?
That's a great question, Tamara. And I think the thing that we think about when we try to answer that question is where is the American public on these core environmental laws and core environmental protections, and then how do we think about the world? Almost two-thirds of Americans believe climate change is occurring. The majority believe it's caused by human activity. In Washington, 69% of Washingtonians believe we should be taking climate action. And, you know, as we know, the U.S. tends to be the outlier on this issue. So there's both local, national, and global support for climate action. The disturbing part, disturbing statistic embedded in there is only 1 in 10 Americans understand that there is scientific consensus on the basic facts of climate. So Americans are actually supportive of climate action without necessarily understanding what scientists are urging all of us to know. We work, like many of us do, both globally and in a very hyper-local way, both in the U.S. and communities around Washington, around the United States, as well as around the world. And in terms of where the conservation movement needs to go, I don't think a Clinton administration would have taken any of the urgency off this, but we really do need to be engaging on the basis of core shared values across the ideological divides, because that's a giant miss. And you can just look at the Obama administration's leadership on climate, but I think every major environmental group was recognizing there was going to be no action in Congress for the foreseeable future. So, you know, even in other, again, no matter who the president is, this core set of beliefs and issues need to be addressed and need to be brought into the middle of the conversation. So we're looking at what is a suite of things that we can be doing at the local and state level, much as Bill Newcomb urged us all to think about today. And then the world, you know, the world just convened in Marrakesh to reconfirm our global commitment to climate action, and that's full steam ahead. Reaching those Paris, you know, targets is a huge challenge, no matter who's president. And I think we just have to really redouble our efforts. Just to, you know, not seem too naive about it, but Mr. Pruitt's nomination clearly raises huge red flags for us, just in the sense of, you know, I think the American public supports those core environmental laws and the protections and benefits they provide to us, and I think we will, you know, we will be working with the administration and others to make sure those are upheld.
So the Nature Conservancy is in a lot of work here in Washington State as well to do what you're doing in terms of bridging those divides ideologically. Do you have any takeaways in terms of the work that you've done that would be helpful, you know, beyond climate or environmental work that, that folks can focus on in terms of bringing people together to find that common ground?
So we, when we have team meetings, it's interesting because some of our team, say, is working on urban stormwater protection in King County, so the communities we're working with there, you know, are extremely diverse and urban and represent many different backgrounds. But many of our team are driving up and down rural roads across the state that were lined with Trump-Pence signs. And we have to find ways to work across that full range of communities to really figure out, again, what are the core values that we share and kind of what's that 80-20 rule? What's eight, you know, where can we come to agreement and where do we just need to put aside disagreement to move forward? We do have a set of organizational values. They include respect for people, communities, and culture, commitment to diversity. If we can't engage in a dialogue that honors those values, then we have to walk away or wait for a better context to develop. But if we can agree on those kind of fundamentals of respect and dignity, then it's time to get to work. And we see people rally around flood protection that also yields salmon habitat, urban stormwater protection that also makes communities in an urban area more livable, dealing with fisheries in a way that benefits tribes and local fishing communities on the coast that also protects the ocean. And I think those are the wins that we're, that are more important than ever now.
Wonderful, thank you. And many of you on the panel have talked about the importance of partnerships in the work that you do. Greg, I'm wondering if you can talk a little bit about, you know, is there a role for NGO business partnerships in terms of advocating for development assistance within Congress and in the new administration?
Yeah, and you know, I think as we obviously don't know where a lot of things are headed. I really appreciate your comments, and what we do know is we mostly missed something, right? You know, it was a big surprise, and so I don't think we understood broadly the importance of these issues of immigration and radicalization and growth of business to the American people, and so. I think that's an opportunity. So I'm an optimist that we have a strong story. Take immigration, for example. I'm a water guy, so I'm going to look at most things through a water lens. And I just came back from Honduras, where we have a water program that provided a basis of water for the community and improved health. But then we've worked with the farmers to increase agricultural practices. But that wasn't enough. And this community, this one community I was in, they had lost 82 of their youth last year. Immigration, either immigrating into San Pedro Sula or taking the beast to the U.S., right? A dangerous journey. But what that community did with their basis of water, they just started communal gardens. And they said, we're going to reach out to our youth deliberately. Every adult took a youth with them into the gardens to farm and said, this will be yours. And more than that, you're going to be a member of our savings and loan group immediately. And immigration from away from that community went from 82 to two. And those two people, they told me, have recently come back. So these are the kinds of stories that we need to tell and let people know that, you know, one of the ways to address immigration is to address it in the home countries where we can. And if you create economic opportunities, then you can really turn things around. And I think the story of business, I think that's a powerful story of NGOs when we can partner with our private sector partners to go to congressional leaders, a big balance, and even go to the Trump administration and say, here's how this is going to be good. This is going to be good for business. Before I joined World Vision, I was at Procter & Gamble, and one of the things that we did was Procter & Gamble went into congressional leaders with our NGO partners to talk about our not-for-profit water work. Now, why would we do that? It wasn't a specific agenda that would give P&G a tax break or resolve a dispute. It established a relationship with that congressional leader. And they knew we were sort of on the side of the angels with our water work. And those relationships are so fundamental when it comes to something that may be more a difficult conversation later on. So I think it's a pretty easy sell to business of why they should go in and brief our congressional leaders for a pro-development assistance that can build business.
And that's more important now than it's been in recent years. One quick example from our world, Kay Granger was chairwoman of the House Appropriations Committee, a key Republican voice on these issues. You know, she's broadly supportive of global health and development, but hadn't been a champion for our issue. We ended up doing an event in her backyard, Dallas, Fort Worth area. We brought former President Bush, who started the President's Malaria Initiative, and we brought three Fortune 500 CEOs, Rex Tillerson from Exxon, we had AT&T, we had Kimberly Clark, all in her backyard, talking about why malaria matters to their businesses. And it was kind of a conversion moment for her on the issue, and she's become a real outspoken champion. And so, again, knowing your audience and given what we know about this administration, I think those business voices, and not just us telling the story of business, but those business leaders being willing to be outspoken on these issues is hugely important.
I'd also like to piggyback on your discussion around Honduras to make another point that I think is pretty relevant here. So I spent a lot of my early career working in Honduras, and I lived in Honduras for a couple of years in the early 90s. And when I first started working in Honduras, actually both Republican and Democrat, so right to left, people appreciated land rights or property rights. They used different words, but it was on the agenda, and it was understood as an important part of the development process. And then when structural adjustment came in, with the view that basically markets work and we don't need to worry about institutions of government, we don't need directed poverty programs. That played out in a particular way that a de-investment or de-emphasis on the agricultural sector and on things like land rights in Honduras, that some of us, like me, were saying, well, if that happens, all these people are going to just go to San Pedro Sula prematurely before the maquiladora industry and others can absorb them. And others are saying, no, the maquiladora is a solution. And you know, Honduras is now the murder capital of the world. Maybe there's a lot of violence, lots of problems, and the migration story that you told. And you know, the structural adjustment kind of approach at some point switched to structural adjustment with a human face. And so we saw kind of bringing back in some attention to things like land rights or other directed poverty programs. And now we're in a really sweet spot, I think, where we have economic growth that reaches the poor. And so we have attention to those things that connect growth driven by private sector and an appreciation of the private sector driving growth and development, but that reaches the poor being important. And I worry, you know, for example, if we have a pendulum swing to back to sort of the market's work and people who come from the business community who maybe aren't yet versed in shared value and some of these new standards that are out there, that we might see a pendulum swing back. But I think we have an opportunity because some of these, someone said on an early panel this morning, I think my colleague Dave Bledsoe actually said it from Landesa, that, you know, the U.S. government, just like any other government, change does take time. So we have some time to advocate and sort of making these stories and these understandings about why development is, in fact, important even in a context of paying attention at home first, and why the kind of equation between growth and markets and poverty needs to not be disbalanced. Is I think we need to do some kind of advocacy. I know Landesa is looking to do some advocacy, more reaching out to the average American to gain understandings about some of these things. So that could be an interesting kind of partnership from here.
Yeah, thank you, Julie. Kind of pivoting from that, Lynn, I'd love to hear your thoughts on, you know, we have an estimated, you know, over a little over 65 million forcibly displaced people now in the world, and there's a lot of concerns about kind of falling health or child marriages or education delays there. Washington State has been one of the rare states where we have a governor who stepped forward and welcomed Syrian refugees. I know you and Congressman Adam Smith have worked a lot on this issue as well on a global scale. So how do you see U.S. policy toward displaced populations changing under the new administration? And what efforts are you aware of that are underway in order to support those populations?
Well, thank you for that question. And certainly from the rhetorics and from the sounds of things, certainly there seems to be a sentiment about, oh, you know, we can't worry about them. We got to worry about America first and notions of that. And displacement seems to be, you know, if we need to create some kind of a safe zone or something over there that they wouldn't come back over here and whatnot. But, you know, Adam has certainly has, you know, he and many other members of Congress actually has been working in the forefront to kind of like look at this from this very much a pro-America first kind of notion. And that is for those refugees that are coming to the United States, I know he and others have proposed legislation to, again, increase support and increasing assistance for refugees resettlement funding for them. I mean, it's amazingly weird that for a long period of time, the notions of all of the social program in the United States is about self-sufficiency, right? We all think of terms of like welfare, food stamps, all these things are about self-sufficiency. And for a while, the refugees resettlement fund for families and individuals was at a pretty long, sustainable level that is matching with most of these short-term training, job training programs so that by the end of that, they will be pretty much self-sufficient. The cutting and undercutting of those of that funding and relocation of support actually make more families becoming part of the TANF and welfare system, making them even more dependent on the federal government in the long term. And so Adam has and others have proposed legislation, working to draft legislation to, again, to say, hey, you know what, to address and bring in extending resettlement assistance to refugees is actually, you know, restore the sense of self-sufficiency. The notions of, you know, American values and American dreams does work, and if you're in that aspect. And it also address the issue of security, of targeting and countering radicalization, because the underpinning of radicalizations in whatever context, whether it's religious, fanaticism, or whatnot, is about economic impoverishment. And we solve that problem here first. We clearly have been an example to the world that America, the notions of integrations in the United States is done, in fact, better than most other countries around the world, including our European allies in that aspect. So that is one example of how y'all can help in terms of like reaching out to members of your partners and your membership to say, hey, you know what, that might be an angle that we can approach this in this administration, for example. But to the notion, but also it warms my heart actually when for a long time the president-elect was. You know, pretty much bend on bringing back, you know, torture and other forms of, you know, creative interrogation techniques. But, you know, General Mattis was able to convince him that actually cigarettes and water and some other stuff actually works better. And so the fact that he is listening to certain individuals that came from the defense component on DOD side has actually been partners with development, global development community in the past is a good thing, is a good opportunity for all of us to pull out our decks of cards and reach out to those former generals and current DOD staff and say, hey, you know, how can we be better partner in this, in crafting that message that DOD is in fact, development is in fact a great ROI for DOD. And that it is going to solve not just national security but global security issue when we tackle displacement, when we tackle refugees crisis around the world.
I mean, I think you're right. Radicalization, if we don't help people now at the time they need it most, then, you know, we'll be judged by that, and people will judge us by that. A young person that's fleeing Mosul now, if they have nowhere to go, you know, if there's no help for them, you know, think of that situation. Versus if they know that our global health partners, the faith-based community that largely voted for, in many cases, for Trump, you know, if they know that this is our time to stand strong, to provide them with economic opportunity, to provide them with shelter and clothing, it's a different story.
So yeah, but we do that in the context of how they understand and appreciate that message. For example, with the faith-based, because we say we help other people because God commanded us to do so. I mean, it's like, so drafting that message can be that simple, and we can't just, you know, from my vantage point, it's not about talking, I was sharing my opinion with you early at lunch. It was like, we can't just draft a message in terms of like with somebody with a postgraduate degree, right? We got to do it in a way that makes sense to people at the core fundamental level, that speaks to their values, that speaks to their, you know, the way of being rather than the way of doing things. Mm-hmm. And that, you know, gives us pause. It gives us some time, right, to turn back and ask ourselves, who am I, first and foremost, right? And so if once we're clear about who we are, then we can articulate those values that can often quite connecting well with other Americans who feel the same way.
Yeah. Kind of let's open it up and have more kind of group conversation now. Yeah. So foreign aid and international development have been considered traditionally a bipartisan effort, and one that's been unfortunately eroding a little bit lately. Do you see the election of Donald Trump as kind of furthering that erosion, or is this an opportunity for the existing bipartisan efforts to be strengthened and built upon?
I would say if we're looking at it through a Democratic-Republican lens, and it's not as clear if that's the case, but when Bush was in our president, it was more pro-business in the development agenda. The role for business was more clear. There was a little bit more of a receptive ear. So if it's that like that, then I think there's probably more opportunity for public-private partnerships to make the case that development is good for business. But I would say we're not sure. We don't know if that's going to be the case. But.
I would say look for opportunity. It was, you know, it's hard to put yourself back in that mindset, but it certainly wasn't clear when President Bush was elected that he was going to be perhaps the most ambitious progressive president, arguably in American history, on global health issues, right?
Right.
On September 11th, 2001, there was no way to guess that the Global Fund, PEPFAR, the U.S. President's Malaria Initiative, that these things were all going to come from this presidency. And yet they have, and they've turned the tide on arguably two of the deadliest diseases in human history, and are making progress on a third, tuberculosis. So, you know, let's look for those kinds of opportunities, and they may exist under a Trump administration.
Yeah, and I would like just add that two points. One is that the issue of bipartisan support is generally important, but I read a statistic that I don't know, I haven't looked into it very much beyond just reading it, but there was an article that I read recently that said that U.S. development aid to Africa in particular is actually higher when the Congress is dominated by one party or the other, regardless of which party it is, than when it's more evenly split. So, you know, for some issue areas, maybe it's okay that it's biased in one way right now. But the other thing is, I also wanted to agree with what you said. I think in the last few years, I feel a very palpable, bigger traction on partnerships between civil society and businesses, so the theme of this conference, and that is pretty bipartisan in and of itself, and I think has meaning for a lot of the other points and things that we've discussed on this panel so far.
I think one of the challenges in the environmental sector is that we were too much about the environment for many years and forgot to speak to core kind of people-based values, and I think as we look at the global challenge in front of all of us, 9 to 10 billion people on the planet, it becomes, you know, there's not just the concern about what happens to the Amazon or the Arctic or, name your favorite land or seascape around the planet or Puget Sound, but it also, you know, it's just a core question about the life support services and systems that nature provides. And I think we are really in the environmental sector. You had asked earlier, Tamara, about how do we need to rethink the conservation movement, but in light of divides and limited resources, we really are trying to reframe a lot of these challenges as how do we deliver benefits to people, and in almost every case, get really enormous benefits for nature at the same time, which are self-reinforcing. And again, appealing to as broad a set of values as possible really matters. And I think on the business side, I think business totally gets this. And I think one of our responses post-election is, this next generation of CEOs taking the mantle at big corporations get it. 365 companies signed a letter to the president-elect, essentially imploring him to stay the course on carbon emissions reductions. And I think there is a generational transition happening, but we do need to then engage corporations in the actual tactical pieces of how we benefit people around the world as we promote growth that helps those communities. But I think just expanding that vision is a key part of the strategy for us going forward.
And I was just thinking, were you guys here last year at Global Washington Conference too? No? Okay, I know some of you are.
I was here.
Oh, great. And so I was like, oh my God, this epiphany moment. It's like, what was the theme of last year's conference? Anybody say? You remember? Disruptions, right? Something in that theme. Ha ha, where's this the biggest, disruption there is or is. And so I would say pull back last year's stuff and tools and say, oh my gosh, you were actually useful, this stuff, every conference and everything. Be careful what you wish for is another phrase. But to say now we are the disruption, right? To think of it as ourselves that, oh, we are disruption. This is a joke that you guys have heard this, I know, when you travel around the world. When the United States sneezes, the world catch a cold, right? Look at this way. I mean, here's an opportunity for us to inoculate ourselves, right? To see what that germ and bacteria feels like in our body that make us a little bit sick. Why are you laughing? But that could be a good thing because then it makes us stronger. It makes us more resilient. And I think that was part of the theme of last year, I remember correctly. We talked about how to build resiliency. Right? I have an incredible, crazy, and forgetful memory, but somehow I remember this. And so resiliency helps. And so we need to exercise more of our muscles, eat more right, and come back to our fundamental values and nurture ourselves better. Because once we know how to do this well for us as a country, in this context, we will know how to do it better for others around the world too. And so that's my sort of once in a blue moon moments of moment. So I don't know, that may help a little bit. And certainly humor is a fantastic way of curing diseases.
We need a cartoonist to do the design of the U.S. with a cold.
Right.
So the disruption came, but it's not from where we expected it.
Absolutely.
In looking at development assistance, the U.S. provides about 24% of the funding internationally. If there is a reduction in that funding, as many other countries look to the U.S. as a kind of influence in terms of how much they end up putting into that fund as well, do you think that if the U.S. reduces, it will spur other governments to contribute at a higher level and fill that gap, or do you think that that would spur a kind of global reduction in terms of funding for global development?
I think there's a huge risk that it would be reductions across the board. The U.S. has been the spark that lit global health and development expansion around the world. If you think back to the founding of the Global Fund, I mean, the Global Fund is the biggest single funder of malaria, HIV, and TB work, increasingly health system strengthening in the developing world. The entire institution probably wouldn't have gotten off the ground if President Bush hadn't decided this is something I'm going to back and back in a big way and actually made a commitment to fund up to a third of the overall budget for the Global Fund. You know, there is a lot of pressure across Europe for countries to be thinking about themselves first. And it's a global partnership, and if the U.S. stepped away, I think there's a huge risk that others would do likewise.
I feel the same way, and we have to work as hard as we can to make sure that that doesn't happen. But if that pie gets smaller, we have to look at other pies. And what we're very encouraged at World Vision this week, Forbes magazine has an article. They convened a panel of 10 different independent judges to look at the biggest bets in philanthropy. So this is another pie that we can look at.
Right.
And they had them rank the nearly 60 gifts that were over $25 million. And the good news for this audience is that global health was in there. In fact, World Vision's water program, a donation from Dave and Dana Dornsife that was $40 million, was in the top five. And they even used the article to tell the Dornsife's gift from the perspective of why you should make this bet in global health. And the criteria were, briefly, that the goals should be something that philanthropy can make a difference in, really move the needle, and that there should be a track record of results, so it's realistic. And so our goal to reach one new person with 10 seconds with clean water by 2020 is a realistic goal that we've shown realism in because we've increased our impact tenfold in the last 5 years with little government funding, so it's possible. And then they had a goal of it's got to be ambitious, and it's got to be clear. And our goal is to end the global water crisis everywhere we work by 2030. That's pretty ambitious, but we know we're going to be able to do it. And finally, it was about the donor grantee relationship, and our relationship was rated the highest in that regard because, in large part, because our donors go to the field and see the work and see how lives are transformed. So my point is that, first of all, it's good that we can make this case in global health that we are the best bets to move the needle socially. And so if the government pie gets smaller, God forbid that happens, but if it does, then there's other places we can compete. But
let's be honest with ourselves. Private sector capital is not going to replace a massive reduction in public sector capital.
Right.
I mean, the relative scale of those things is pretty lopsided. But you need to look no further than the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation to see, you know, what has become the second largest development agency in the world. And so there are some extraordinary examples of that happening at significant scale.
And private sector investment is bigger than in developing world, is bigger than developmental assistance. So, you know, 10 times larger. So if we can go after private sector partnerships that allow us to advance our different areas, then that's another big source of funding.
Yeah, a core part of the Paris Climate Agreements was the $100 billion investment fund that countries would put together primarily to drive adaptation, resilience, and mitigation efforts in developing countries. That really is what brought the deal together ultimately. And there's no question if the United States does not lead in contributing to that fund that other countries will not be as motivated. So, plus just the amount of money that we would be contributing. So I think that is a huge risk in terms of global energy or motivation around funding that effort that then leads to the climate emissions, gas emissions that we need to see. But there's another sort of nuance on this in terms of the corporate response, which is if the dialogue is about let's just get rid of some of these rules as opposed to there's just less money to pursue a shared agenda, then you know, we're going to get a couple of different responses from the business community, which is the first thing that the business community does not want to see is changing rules all the time. It's that uncertainty about the rules of the game that drive business leaders crazy. And what we're seeing at the end of 8 years of the Obama administration is business is moving in a bunch of directions, financial regulation, even healthcare, certainly the environment, that's reflective of just what customers want, but also a response to government rules and regulations. And so I think we need to really, there's a bit of a flag on the money, but there's a bigger flag on, are we just going to say a bunch of these rules that drive innovation from the business sector, we're just going to get rid of those when we already have business positively responding and adapting and innovating with those rules in place.
Yeah, I was going to just add a little bit also on the multilateral front that it's a hugely important point that you make. It's not just about what other countries do, but whether it's UN programs or the multilaterals like the World Bank, there was really clear documented evidence back in the 90s when the U.S. government chose to back out of agriculture very soon after not only other bilateral agencies, but the World Bank in particular very, very significantly decreased its funding for agricultural programming. So I think this is actually a big issue to watch. It was interesting comments in the panel before this one of the panels before this where someone brought up the reality that in Africa, China is starting to ramp up its investments and development, so the hydraulics between the U.S. and China, particularly in that continent, could be interesting. And the speaker from the Gates Foundation was mentioning that they are already starting to partner with Chinese scientists in light of those investments to sort of make some good development gains with it. So I don't know where you go with that, but just to say that there are some interesting dynamics to watch.
Yeah.
That way.
Point.
How will each of you be framing up or hoping to shift your relationships and partnerships with government under the new administration? What adaptations are you doing to your current strategies?
Well, we have chapters in all 50 states, and we have boards of trustees in all 50 states. So, the board composition in Alabama looks different than it does in Oklahoma, looks different than it does in Vermont, and looks different than it is in Washington. And it's actually a great source of strength for the organization in that, mentioning Lynn, we have an annual lobby day on Capitol Hill, and we're able to meet with members from every single state and across the ideological spectrum. And what I think we're going to see is it's just very practical. What benefits can those members of Congress deliver to their districts on these core priorities, in the U.S.? And then we need to be able to tell a really great story about the synergy of international commitments to the interests of those members of the House, and also in terms of security issues, global instability, and just human well-being. But I just think it's more of the same. It just, we need to do it better and more intensively than we might have had to.
More better.
More better.
Great.
Yeah, so I'll just say just a couple quick things. So we're, like everyone, I think we're watching and waiting, but Landesa's funding is not primarily from the public sector. We do work with the U.S. government and with the U.K. government and other governments in terms of funding. We also have really strong partnerships with the governments in the countries where we have programs, like the state-level governments, the national government in India. And I don't feel like there's going to be a big implication other than sort of the broader whether funding writ large shrinks. But I think we're in a fairly good position. I think our issue area also is one that, at least I've seen historically, be relevant to the agendas across political spectrums, and I think we can make it. I think one of the things that at least I personally have thought about, and I know some of my staff have commented about, is if depending on where this administration takes us and where the development community go around women's rights and girls, adolescent girls and things like that, will we have sort of a reduced credibility in our own advocacy around women's land rights, which is a huge issue area for us? We haven't thought through that, but it's just, this is kind of your point about if we can do things better at home, we're better ambassadors for it overseas. And so there could be some reverberation about how we're able to speak into certain conversations, but we haven't jumped very far ahead in our thinking.
Yeah, similar to what Bill Newcomb was saying earlier, that we have the challenge and we have the opportunity to be an example in a lot of ways, particularly here in the Northwest and in Seattle. Right. But it's our mantle to take up if we want to accomplish that.
And for us, we're spending a lot of time talking to our donors. And the work probably isn't going to change that much, but the way we talk about it, so the immigration issue, for example, the radicalization issue, I mean, the fact that we're working in Honduras to address the root cause of immigration by providing economic opportunity, that we're right outside of Mosul, ready to assist 100,000 people, that work doesn't change. But the way we talk about it to respond to this groundswell that elected President Trump is going to allow us to reshape our message to be more receptive to some ears, I think.
Okay, and we are coming close to the end of our time here. So I want to say it does not sound like any of you have an easy job here coming up, and probably that's true of most people in the room. Can you leave us with some thoughts in terms of what keeps you motivated? What continues to keep you driven in this work? What gives you hope? What gives you optimism to continue doing what you're doing?
Can I start? You know, what motivates me waking up every day and go to work is a chance to make I know that I have a joke to say that, you know, people ask me what's great about your job, and I said I get to go home to my family every night, and then when I wake up I get to go to my family in the morning. For me, public service tickles every fiber in my body. Your work is incredibly important, and it gotta tickles every fiber in your body as well. For me, it's a matter of life and death for someone. And to be in that space, to be at this time, to be in this moment, is a privilege. And I feel incredibly grateful to be in this space, in this moment in time. That motivates me. And so, and many of my staff, cohorts in Adam's office, feels the same way. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it harkens back to my days when I, you know, jumped out of a perfectly flying airplane and, you know, made it the happiest day of my life when I finished my fifth jump and became a paratrooper. I thought that was the happiest day of my life. And then, today, I said, actually, every day from this moment on, gotta be the happiest of my life as well. And it's what I do, it's how I be in this world tomorrow, the next second. That determines my worth in the world. And I'm motivated as heck and trying to be that.
And we all should be. I mean, just to give a nuance on what Lynn is saying, you know, when we look back on this moment in history, we're going to be remembered for a lot of things. We're going to be remembered for technology advancements and strife in the world and what happens with the climate. But one of the big things that we're going to be remembered for is this is the period in human history where we saved lives at a bigger scale more quickly than at any other time in history.
Absolutely.
And many of you in the room are on the front lines of that work. And, you know, like Lynn was saying, I can't think of a better definition of a good reason to get up in the morning than to be a part of one of the big projects of your age and something that is so undeniably good for the world. And we all have that chance. And however you feel about the election, and people feel very differently about it, that's a gift. And there are a lot of people out there who don't have that sense of purpose and who may be frustrated and don't have a way to channel that. So we're lucky that we do.
That's well said. We know that there's going to be winners and losers in the next 4 years, and we don't know how that's going to play out yet. But as Martin said so well, that, you know, we're going to end extreme poverty by 2030, and our generation is going to be part of that. And for me personally, you know, as a water guy, we're going to end the global water crisis. And that's something that is... you know, it's a moonshot. It's incredible to think that something that's been around forever will be ended. No one will lack basic access to water. So it's what motivates me.
Yeah, so I could say the same thing about land rights. It's just been the passion and core of my career for a very long time. But two thoughts that I had were one at a sort of bigger picture level. When I see that there's a problem, I tend to want to double down and solve it. So if I feel like the world we're heading towards is not the world I want, or we want, as expressed by the SDGs, I feel like doubling down, and that's motivating to kind of figure out how to get there. The other thing is just more personal. I've been for a long time wanting to cause myself to spend more time on the domestic scene and connecting my work with it, and so there's nothing like something to cause you into action when you've been kind of talking about it for too long, because that's kind of motivating.
I'll offer two snapshots that summarize what inspires me. One, last month we were in Mahale National Park on the shores of Lake Tanganyika in Tanzania, and we have a great team that's working on reproductive health and the ties to fishing and forests and agricultural management there. And the Conservancy's team helped start a drama group in one of the villages, and watching these young people sort of tell the story of how women's choices and power directly lead to consequences for fish and chimpanzees in the forests and everybody around them is just, you know, really one of my proudest moments in, 25 years of work. And then the other snapshot is here locally, going to a beach out on the Olympic Peninsula with a Macaw tribal leader and being introduced to this secret beach that his family has been going to for, you know, since the ice receded thousands of years ago, and just being introduced and welcomed into that oral tradition and history and perspective. That's why I do what I do.
Wonderful. Well, thank you to our panelists for your insight and your advice and guidance, and thank you all for joining us. I hope you have a wonderful rest of the conference, and please stick after if you have any questions to ask the panelists yourself.
Thank you. Thank you, Tamara. I want to add my thanks to the panelists, too, as they're here. And just want to say that Global Washington is going to pick up this conversation and bring it forward next year. We have monthly events. We'll be looking at the issues of how to work in a Trump administration throughout the year, and you'll probably see it at next year's conference. And thank you, Lynn, for bringing up last year's conference. We can bundle them all together. So, and before we leave too, I really want to take this moment to thank the host committee and planning committee and my board. So if you're on one of those, please stand up. Please stand up. Host committee, planning committee, and the Global Washington board. Thank you so much. Thank you very much. So we now have just a 10-minute break, and then again more breakout sessions. So there's again five to choose from, and then we'll come back at plenary at the end. Thank you very much.